Yes, I was thinking about what is space and I wanted to kind of say something, many kind of negative things, saying that and this you have.
Say something what?
Negative. I would be saying many negative.
Negative things.
Because I believe we have our head still full of junk. And this is, you know, to solve certain interesting, resolve some interesting questions, you have to be cleaned up. And.
Well, Misha, I can't hear you when you're facing enough to hear half of it, okay.
And just, you may say, well, after all, we're just making some progress, but if you look at some kind of issues, how the progress is goes, one question I'll address a little bit is the question of how people think. And that all this document we have is like that. It was a 15 centuries of the old era. It's called Surgical Papyrus by somebody Smith. But what it does, it refers to something which was about that long. So it was 3,000. Some person called, I think, last subject like Inskip, who wrote it, from who it was borrowed, who explained how mind works. And he was saying about brain, da da da. And nothing changed, I mean, from that period of time. We have not learned anything. If you read what says now, like a rather temporal great person like Crick, what he says, he would rather repeat what they say, but with much more emphasis, saying everybody going to argue. So this guy believed, was saying it was common knowledge, more or less at that time. And then became kind of question. And of course, none of them could say it the way it would say to our satisfaction. Otherwise, we wouldn't keep saying this for so long time.
Wait, so what is this thing that was common knowledge?
The brain determines your mind.
The brain determines what?
Your mind. But again, determined is...
You mean the organ, the brain?
Yeah, there is brain, and there is mind, and there is something kind of error, and what we have most with the name of it. People give different names. The thing they invent very small, clever name. They say something, and the Greek invents some teacher names, and this guy, like Shakespeare said, you know, the fancy breath, where the fancy breath in the heart or in the head. So the fancy breath in the heart, in the head, period. And then you can show this in Hebrew.
You're not talking about space, you're talking about this question.
Yeah, but this question, yes, okay. I just want to, yeah. I'll come to that, yeah, because this okay. Is related to the question of space. And then just, you know, and then there was nothing was happening, and just to have an idea how recently, at least, we were, and because he would be even be civilized, still they were kind of absurd in our mind. I think it's a great story. I keep forgetting the name of the guy who first realized the reason why women giving birth died in the hospital. There was an infection which was distributed by medical profession who were taking the birth. But it was their hands. And the guy who discovered that, and he started doing that well, and nobody was dying to see him. And what was the result? How professionally reacted to that? What did they do, you know?
Killed him.
They killed him.
I'm guessing.
Exactly. They brought him to the madhouse, saying he mad, and then the warden beat him to death. And this was, I think, was right, because he was saying very obnoxious things. And they're not, because initially they believed he was wrong, because the consensus was that it wouldn't be so, despite the fact. And then the fact, and the same we have kind of around mathematics and on my mind, and the reason in my view
so we
is,
may kill you.
Sure, yes, exactly. If I would say exactly what I think about everything, the way would be very dead, yeah. So keep my mouth shut from the book.
No, in this country you can say anything.
No, well, I didn't raise my life.
Clear, I mean, look at the presidential campaign.
In fact, they didn't say, even Trump didn't say what that he could have said. Yeah, I would say it to you, yeah.
Okay.
Because the obvious, actually, the obvious things, nothing hidden, just what you say about these characters, it would be immediately good. Because exactly the full truth nobody wants to say it about. We can insult the whole country. Okay. So, and now about this space. About mathematical notions. And so my point is that if we work the spaces as a geometer, I just space my major kind of objects, and it's hard to mean that an algebra is something else which I don't talk, will not talk. And there are two aspects which you can, well, there are many aspects in mathematics, but you can think in two different terms. You have kind of flowers, some particular kind of beautiful theorems, and then there is a background where you want to put them. And so you don't speak now about flowers, but about this background. And sometimes you get very annoyed. Where is my flower? You don't speak about flowers. It's only the background.
Just the earth.
Yes, earth, yeah. And without that, you cannot have flowers. On the other hand, of course, we enjoy flowers. But it's a different way of thinking. And there are, of course, others. And one kind of... So there's a fundamental point behind what I'm saying, very closely related to that. You want to understand what is mathematics. So you want to know the answer to this question. And sometimes people say this or that. But by definition, any answer which you can say 200, 300 words will be absurd. Yeah, quite a very long, very long answer.
Well, and what's the question?
What is mathematics?
No, but what is that question?
Exactly. You have to know what the question is. Absolutely. First, you have to formulate properly the question, properly. It will be answerable, and then to think about the answer.
Okay, what is the question?
The question is, you can say, the question for me is follows. What is the right class of structures? So mathematics will be certainly a member of this class. It might be class of structures sufficiently good enough, and of course, it will describe itself mathematically. So there is, of course, the circle. Huh? But again, without self-referential circles, you cannot do anything. If you want to root them out, but the moment you throw them away, poop, you're at it.
You want a mathematical definition of a class of activities, let's say intellectual, mental activities, the rules and of which mathematics could be identified with.
Yeah, the mental will be some of them. They're not mental, a priori. They're kind of structures, mathematical structures,
okay,
which will be related to mental activities. And describing mathematics, and the example I have in mind, I just keep saying it, when you look at Ramanujan, who received input 5,000 formulas, and then make output, I think, 4,000. So what is it? There was a mathematical machine there. What was this machine? So here you imitate this machine, you get...
Can you explain what you meant by
5,000? Here, Ramanujan read a book which contained 5,000, he was 15 years old. He read a book containing so many formulas. And then he didn't have any other input, essentially, mathematically. And then he was producing his own formulas. And then he wrote about 1,000. And so there was something having a machine in his mind. But mathematical machine, we want to understand it. That's part of mathematics. Unless we understand what kind of machine was there, we don't understand mathematics. This is what we know about mathematics. Everything else is fantasy, right? But this we know. People learn mathematics, and then it goes out. And this is similar to language, but in a way better, suitable for the study. Again, language is something similar. Children, they have input of language coming, and then they start talking. And so people muse a lot how the health can work. And of course, they have no idea about that. And there are explanations. Some people refer to God, or call this God evolution, or mutation, but it's the same kind of, run away from the question. The question is, you have to work hard to create sufficiently workable mathematical model which you can check on computer and see if they work and do that. And the question, what are these models? And if you look at the miniature of this question, particular cases...
Well, is there such a model?
No. Well, I have some idea what it should be.
No, but what about the existence? Are you sure there is such a model? You're saying you can put it on a computer, so...
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Sort of
well,
wrong.
Again, of course I cannot be sure. But if you say, does it exist, it's surrender. You can say, I don't do it. The only way to... Of course, you believe such model exists, then you know how to do such. And of course, there are little progress in the. But if you look at people who are functioning in artificial intelligence, you can see how kind of limited they were, and I may explain one of the mistakes they had. They used mathematics, they believed they know what mathematics was. They used mathematics, they knew. Actually, I had experience with this a couple of times. I had the honor talking to Chomsky, and he also shocked me. He thought in mathematical terms, 50 years ago, how people were doing that. To take some mathematics and believe that's kind of the mathematics. Mathematics is not like that. What you know, what was 50, 60 years ago, now can we forget about that. It's not to your good. For conceptual understanding of things outside mathematics. So we have to, and mathematics today tells you that what we have is not good, and what we have is not good, we have to invent it. We have to invent new kind of mathematics to be able to start talking about this question. And of course, gradient of development of mathematics tells more or less where to go, but it doesn't go exactly. So now look at some question more specific. When I thought more carefully from this point of view. So that the idea I want to say, you look at some phenomenon, something, and then try to formalize it as best as you can. And history tells you the mistakes which have been made. So you want to try to avoid them, not that you do something perfect, but at least something slightly different. And so, and the examples I was thinking mostly was measure spaces and metric spaces, which you want to understand what they are from a different perspective. And so I start with what I thought more. What is a measure space?
Well, you're going to take two mathematical concepts and critique them, let's say. And how is that going to fit into the previous question?
Right, exactly.
No, but how?
Well, because these are concepts, just I want to see how this concept were entering mathematics and what was wrong with them and how it should be changed. Just to, and I come actually to this question back, for example, how to study languages and how to study mathematics, what may be approached. And just you, I want to refresh our vision, say, of basic concepts. And probability is crucial for understanding, say, languages. So what is probability? Right, so at this point, I want to, probability is, in a way, quite significant, because it's just in between, exactly between the mathematics and what's outside of mathematics, which is exactly this kind of domain. And this huge amount of confusion, including, I think, the best physicists who speak about the second law, what they say, ridiculous primitive. Exactly, because they accept, they believe that mathematics they learn is the mathematics. And I think it's not so. Whatever we know, mathematics is assumption, much more than that, which we have to invent. And of course, there is no way of inventing it. So this is a...
There's no way of inventing it on the spot. I mean, you have to work.
Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah. Okay, of course.
What do you mean there's no way of inventing it just like that?
Yeah, of course. You have to think. You need some kind of indicators when and how to go. And in fact, thinking about the way your mind works in this history tells you at least what not to do. So just maybe, let me give you just kind of one instructive point. There is a word, useful. And this is a word which have to be reduced.
Yeah, don't get rid of that.
It's better. Yeah. And this is just, let me give an instance of that. This was what plagued the plague in people trying to develop so-called artificial intelligence robotics. They wanted to make machines which do something useful. And then, if you look at the end of the history, take some great people who made both scientists who contributed tremendously in practical terms, like airports. You know, he invented a lot of the hearing machine for his vision, and he was a theoretician, and he was emphasizing all the time. But if you focus on useful, you never reach, go anywhere. Just in science, it's not right point. And in practical term, I know a group of people in France who do robotics, and the idea is different. They try to make interesting robots, or interesting problems. And they do really very great stuff, and they're not being supported. Because they don't solve any problem. They don't try to solve any problem. They don't try to be useful. They try to understand how this principle works. And amazingly, I spoke to some people like this Sergey Brin, tried to discredit him a few. It's not useful. This is it. And then you never arrive at this why they cannot solve the problem like you. They try to be useful, but you have to understand the thing before that. And then zero understanding. They don't try to understand. The understanding is 19th century math. Very primitive logic, God logic. Very primitive stuff. It's not good here. Okay, so come to this example. Again, let's look at this from a quasi-historical perspective. You can imagine history. How Boltzmann thought about that and how it was transformed. So what you read in a textbook in physics, that entropy is the log of the number of states. And then you want to interpret it, what it is. Right? So what are states? So what's the picture you have in mind? So imagine you have a crystal, just to be simpler than that. Yeah, literally. So Boltzmann was mostly concerned with gases. And so there is something, some molecules here, which can be in so many states. Imagining the states are different colors. It may change colors. And now I'm going to say, what is the number of states? So, in the first we can say, there is the space of all states. But this space of all states, of course, it's just, you say state, it doesn't mean there is a space over there. And you say in mathematics, there is a set which, but it's not so which we have in physics.
It's
absolutely,
it's not what?
There is no such thing. Yeah. In physics, they say in this language, space of all states, all positions of all atoms. For me, it's a nonsensical concept. It doesn't correspond to the to what we are doing with that. And so this is the analogy which I emphasize was not only here but in the class.
In what way does it not correspond?
Okay, so let me say, give an example again. Where the similar question exists and then what is off. So I'm going a little bit ahead of myself, but how we define, so measure spaces, somewhere. So measure space defined by Kolmogorov, in some universal measure space, when you apply it to somewhere, you say, there is measure space describing that. If it's small enough, you add kind of more parameters. It's a huge universal measure space, and you know they're all essentially isomorphic to the square, and so it's area of the square, and so it's kind of actually going back to before. Then this is probability is geometry. However, but you know, very similar concept was developed algebraic geometry by Leroy, who defined points of algebraic variety as points to some universal field. And field was just aging and aging and aging, everything you want, so we have a huge field, and we have a universal field, everything like that. But there, fortunately, the moment this book appeared, Grothendieck came out and said, it's also you know, Grothendieck. It's absurd, it's an artifact. You have to say what is there. And so there came definition of algebraic curve. How to say you need new ambience, and those ambience of categories, functions, no points, you see your net, and without that you can't say. If you say it, you know it's maybe not ultimate reality, but certainly infinitely better. And the same is here. All these states, whatever they are, just no, they're not there. We operate with them, we operate with intermediate notions, and you have to operate with them, not introducing this artifact without kind of need. Yeah, they're not good artifacts. And there's tradition, you do that. So what actually, however, we have this picture. And so we see how many states are there, pretend you know that all this, each molecule may be in some number of states, and then they observe it. But what in reality we observe? So you want to define this number or log of the number of states. And then you see, first, you start observing this system, right? And so entropy is obtained by observation, right? And observation is of the following type. You take a machine, you attach it to your system. It's a little machine. You imagine there are kind of windows where you can look. Okay, three windows. And when you attach it somewhere, it starts blinking. Tick, 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 tick. And I put it in another place, it becomes blinking. Tick, 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 tick. And all you have. And everything we see in the world is like that. We see nothing else. Right? And then from that you say, so you count how many different ticks are here. And then just assume when you move it along. The system doesn't change, so we can average the ticks, and from them you write this formula, you know, for the entropy. And therefore, entropy is the way we use a protocol of our observations. And then there are other, the way Boisson was saying, and mathematicians of that time were fine, what he was saying was absurd, but what he was saying, in fact, in the modern language, first he used non-standard analysis, and then he spoke in categorical language. And mathematicians of the time couldn't understand it. Boisson. If you read what you're saying, Boisson.
Boisson.
Boisson equation. Yes, no, of course he was writing some formulas, and still the right formula. But it actually functor between certain categories and has a natural property, and while you have them, you know what the equation is, you don't have to write it. And you know most of those properties also. Right? So and therefore we have to kind of try to kind of express what he said in the mathematical in this language. And particularly now coming back to measure spaces, which you try to describe because you say, these all the states, there is this measure, what is the measure space? That's the interesting point. We are taught about measure space. And then we say how there are measurable set, but of course set of measure zero we throw away, so there are set of measure zero, so we already work with a, you know, it's 2 to the power continuum. So to speak about this, you need the full developed Frankel Samuel Frankel theory, nobody, of course, answers. Right? They were never eaten, I think, rigorously, by the way. So it's just junk, just nonsense. It's just we cannot accept them. But we didn't somehow accept them before it isn't. Nobody ever checked with Capri. Right? It's impossible, you know, it's volume of kind of junky language. And so how we can live with that? Indeed, it's just that's absurd. And when you work with it, you feel it, and how it's absurd. You work with sets, with points, you know we can throw any point, nothing changes. So what the hell is it? It's obviously wrong language, yeah. And it's here for 70 years. 50 years you have to change mathematical notion every 50 years it is. And so he suggests that this point is very simple language.
No, but points don't exist, but sets of positive measure do exist.
Hmm?
I mean, you don't work, you're not allowed to work with points, you work with sets of positive measure.
What are sets again? Just let me explain how we can. It's so interesting.
Actually, it's equivalence classes, sets of positive measure, modulo sets of measures.
Okay, what number? Well, trying to get out of there by what you're already used to. And this is exactly wrong. Of course, it's universal language, like universal field. You can say everything in this language, but it's just wrong language. Let me explain what. For example, if we just explain some different language, and so what would be nice about this, that once you have this language and translate what Boltzmann was saying, you would have what is called this Kolmogorov entropy and the proof, both definition and the proof of theory. There is nothing to prove. It will come just from definition, from the functionality of the process. That's exactly what the process, which is how Boltzmann described gases, is functorial. He describes the system functorially, out of functoriality, follows both definition of the entropy for crystals, which is called the dynamical system, which is more complicated than that, and all its properties. And you don't have to think about it. Just for physicists, I don't know how they were reacting to that, but it was kind of obvious, yeah? They would never kind of look at this, it was so trivial.
But it wouldn't be unreasonable. I mean, this is not like a revolution. You just say, there's this mathematics of probability theory. It was formulated in the 30s or 40s or 50s by Kolmogorov, et cetera. Yeah. Now you're saying we can sort of enrich it with notions from category
theory. No, we don't enrich it.
Enrich it from category theory, and then we'll satisfy.
No, we bypass it. You didn't say need. We can bypass it completely. It was just artificially brought because of the language of set theory. We don't need this language.
Okay, well then you bypass it. You renew it.
I'm saying you kind of rather trivial, but still. So let me explain some mathematical point which actually made me talk about that. This is just general talk in a second. I come to that. And just look at the following theorem, which I found very pretty, and how to prove it. And it is Wheatney, I forget how I write Wheatney. Somebody else in the policy. Oh, shit, I forget the name. Anyway.
Wait, what's the question?
I don't know, I'll say the theorem and just, if I forgot the name of the author, but the theorem is following. I have a measurable set in R3, and I project it to three planes. So I have number 1, 2, 2, 3, and 3, 1. This will be areas of this. And so in the theorem, if I take the whole volume, this to the power 2, it'll be less or equal than 1, 2 times 2, 3 times 1, 3. This meaning areas of projection. Okay. So that's the theorem. And it's interestingly enough, it certainly implies that you
draw the theorem over here, too. I can't.
So we have this set.
Right. You project in the plane?
In three spaces. You project it to two planes.
Three planes.
Yeah, multiply this area, you get bigger than the square of the volume.
Oh.
Square, of course, you have to write them beneath.
The three shadows multiplied is bigger than the square.
Right. In particular, it gives you non-sharp hypermetric inequality. And so. And so just. How we may prove this? So it looks kind of non-trivial geometric theory. But the point is that...
So pi cubed is bigger than 16 pi squared? That doesn't sound right.
It seems like this.
I'm checking it
for
the wall.
No,
but I want to do it for the wall.
It is
too. Huh?
It is two-dimensional areas.
with the volume of the sphere, 4 pi.
Why should there be any...
4 pi squared is 16 squared pi squared. This one, oh, is 2 pi. Oh, 8 pi.
But here it is, this. That's all.
Oh, well.
I'm going to explain.
Okay. You're going
to
prove it. Okay.
So, and the point is that it follows from the law of large numbers. This was what was amusing. And actually, it is what is behind it is entropy. Somebody explained it to me later. And then I realized that this is a kind of what makes.
Can you tell us what your law of large numbers is?
Yeah, okay, I shall explain in a second. So first observe that if you can exactly in the measure space paragraph, then K is being R3, you just have product of three measure spaces. And you have a subset in there. And again, you don't care about this measure space, you just find the sets. You just look at the cardinality. You take the product of three sets, take subsets and their product, and the cardinality of this subset, bound it in terms of projection of these two, three coordinates. Right, so it's kind of combinatorial statement, but you have to prove it, however, right? And then you make the following observation, that if this theorem is true for subset here, you just can take it to some Cartesian power, the whole picture. This power, this power, this power, this power. And if you be true up to that, you'll be true there. So you only make it more general, or you change nothing. So you can go to any power you want. Okay? And now, the point is that if you have this projection, for example, and start taking the powers, then almost all slices of the project, the number of elements in every slice, will be approximately the same, the law of large numbers. So in more kind of general term, if I take any finite measure space, so it's a bunch of points with weights, totality is one, probability space, and take it to the high power. So I have kind of new kind of space where elements will be product of this. It's still mass one. But now, predominant number of points will have approximately the same mass, and the rest will have tail of very small mass. Therefore,
most of the points have the same mass.
The same mass. Yeah. And this
that's
is
a
low-less number.
Argument.
Yeah, this is low-less number. In the form, which is kind of more suitable here. And by the way, yeah, as far as low large numbers, it's interesting. The mathematical, really, the core mathematical point for many proofs is just Pythagorean theorem. This, by the way, one of the great
theorem.
Yeah?
What?
Pythagorean theorem. It follows from that. Yes, many things follow. Actually, I found out that many things in sister algebras, you look at the proof in 10 pages, and then you just throw them on, use Pythagorean theorem. And all is used. All this Hilbert space separated, of course, based on that. Oh. Everything else is just good.
Okay. Little things, yeah.
I may mention some kind of specific point about that later. Okay, so. But
and
the
how
one.
How did the Pythagorean theorem fit into this?
Huh?
How did this come in?
No, because because the law of large numbers. So how you prove it? Because you apply to the 12 to norm and this add together by Pythagorean theorem, so you have estimate 12 to, and that's it.
Oh, you're using the Pythagorean theorem to prove the law of large
numbers. And well, there are other proofs, but this is the most the shortest one. And so what we have, so we can assume that our set has a property. This projection in all the three directions have constant fibers. And therefore they're just products. So I have just products of three things, and that's it. There is nothing to prove, become kind of a polish.
Well, what's the proof again?
Because you go to this high power, kind of go, so to speak, to the limit. Yeah. This, by the way, if you want to be careful, it will be the limit in terms of non-standard analysis. Right? You might be careful because it is not your limit. But in the terminal set nice, you take a huge, and you can throw all infinitesimals. And then you have the picture when you have this set and the subset, where here projection, all these fibers, when they project, they have equal masses. Therefore, volume will be product of this by product of this. But slices here come from slices here. So they just have three numbers, A, B, C. Something thrown away became small, and they have a quality, of course. Therefore, I had a quality before I went to the limit. In this way, by the way, Prof. Hodge heard the inequalities that all the
where does the square come in?
Yeah, Because you see, but if your spaces, you know, your projection, these fibers all, you project it here. Here now it's a measure space. There are fibers. Maintain the powers and become kind of approximate the product.
Right. I got that part. But you had the square in the statement, the product of the three projections
right.
is bigger than the square of the volume.
Right. But
where'd that square come from?
Because you come to constant, because here is a square. If you take the rectangle of the square, because ABC equal AB, BC, AC, and you have to take the square from this thing. Right, because for rectangle, for solid, you have this formula. Square of the volume, product, I see, equal the product of the area. And then you degenerate to this case. So in the limit,
you're going to perturb this identity to prove the theorem.
Yeah. Well, of course, I use the limit. No, actually, finally, this kind of identity, you know, this identity, you know, again, it's my little digression is also quite exciting. There is another identity of the same type, which is the following, that if we have a matrix and replace each element by the product of this column by this row, sum of the column, sum of the row, okay? Look at this operation. Take a matrix, say sum of elements is 1, right? Say product of elements 1. Then take some point of the matrix, say column, add things together in a row, add together, multiply them, and put them in this place. So I have a map and this, and normalize again to have mass 1. I have a map in the space of matrices. So what if we iterate this map?
What do you assume about the matrices?
Just positive numbers.
That's all.
Yeah, you have probabilities usually, total mass is 1.
What?
Is there probabilities? Usually they come from, in a second, they say where they come
from. So row sums are 1?
No. The total sums are 1.
Total sums.
So you take sum of the columns, sum of the row, you multiply, put here. So it's some quadratic map in the space of matrices. So what will be the iterate? You guys.
What?
If you iterate this map, how it behaves? It's a quadratic transformation. Right? So I have a transformation M, call it M. Some reason. And second, say why. So, and the theorem is m squared equals m. And this theorem.
What do you mean?
What is
m
there?
It's map m.
It converges to a projection.
Yeah, it's projected. It's projected. Uh-huh. It is a projector. And this theorem is symmetric matrices, 2 by 2 matrices. Specific formula without understanding what she was writing. Wrote some mathematician whom you know. And this is the most famous theorem. These are mathematicians, you know his name. But you don't know this theorem. However, look at the Google. This will be cited 100 times more than all his work with anybody else. And this is Hardy.
Hardy.
Hardy proved that, called Hardy-Weinberg principle in genetics. And this cited, of course, infinitely more than everything he's ever done. And he did the most significant part. And this, of course, was known to Mendel. But Mendel haven't treated it specifically, but because biologists write identity, some kind of specific identity, A, B, C, D. And because for biologists it was too much, of course Mendel was not accepted. His work was not accepted because people could not, you know, at that time biologists didn't know a multiplication table, you know, algebraic formulas or that, you know.
Oh, he did math, Mendel?
Oh, sure. Of course, he knew math. He was education. He was educated by physicists. And people like Darwin, they really didn't know multiplication table. Literally, they couldn't compute. They were making mistakes by millions in those groups. They had compute 2 plus 2, they had millions. Fantastic. Yeah. And of course, they couldn't understand it. And there was when 30 years later, this came up, and people thought, look, it's nonsense. It's because what it implies, you know, what the consequence of that? You have 2 fields of 2 flowers, say red and blue. And there are red, you know, 10 times smaller than this. So it will be 10 here and 100 here, but there is mountain range. And then mountain range disappears and starts a pollen exchange, and you have a new distribution of them. Or rather, maybe they were equal, maybe even nice to equal, but after distribution, this becomes small and this becomes big. And then, of course, people are like, okay, this is advantage. Repeat it, and this will disappear. No, it stabilizes.
Oh.
and these people were very happy about this Darwinism. What the hell? All this evolution, of course, was nonsense what they were saying. It was true, in a way, a posteriori, but what we were saying, like Darwin, was absolutely absurd. Yeah. they're just saying everybody knew, but they...
Why does it stabilize?
Huh? That's in, it's exactly this map, yeah? Yes, you have a redistribution of alleles, but it's stabilized on the first step. You don't have to, because not be, it's not because one was advantageous, because there were more of them. But until they can, then they...
But you changed it to them being equal.
Hmm?
You changed it to them being equal, didn't you?
No. I had it, I said bad, okay, yeah. First you have them equal.
First they're equal.
And after you move out in way, you become like that. Oh. These become bigger. But if you repeat it for the second time, you do the same. And that's exactly what you observe, have advantages, they come, and they start diminishing. You say, huh, now they eliminate completely the second one. No, it stabilizes. This is why we keep stable thing. We have very many different group, genetic types, different blood groups, yeah? And they don't disappear, they're stable, they have certain...
And why? Why?
Because of this.
Why? Why is that the process?
Okay, well, just think about that. You have these parents, and they randomly mix up. Right?
Ah, okay.
This parents, you add this and this, multiply and you matrix. And this is exactly, of course, what happens. It's done, not that he pulled the
third. Projection out there. Okay.
It's a linear, it's a non-linear projection rate.
But this is not about, I mean, about properties, so this is not related to matrix, right?
Sorry?
So just the property
would
be
very important. Yeah, exactly. With this particular formula, if you write a formula, it says it matches. Which I cannot repeat, of course, yeah. A, B, C, and he was saying it. Multiplication type mathematics, but the only mathematics, of course, he knew, yeah. Harger was a master of multiplication table. But he didn't realize, okay, he wouldn't say the word I said, yeah, he didn't know that. It's amazing, and people keep repeating, by the way, this to the present day.
Excuse me, so you are saying any two processes, if they interact randomly, then...
Yeah, they can mix these alleles, come from here, on random, mix up, so by this law, square will be what? Square is the same. It's, you know, it's very easy kind of, you know, to see. Yeah, if you work in the language of tensor protocols, exactly, A, B, C, no, associativity of tensor protocols, and so on. It's complete tautology. But these people were incensed when they, in the turn of the century, when these ideas came up. All these evolutionists, like Wallace, were not stupid guys. But that's quite amusing. This is actually great point. And biologists knew about this phenomenon. They couldn't believe into that. They couldn't write a formula. I mean, just fantastic. And so Hardy and Guy Weinberg wrote, I think, 80 pages paper. He was a doctor. And so they are blind. No, you don't have to laugh at these people. My point is, we can't laugh at them, but we have to know we are no better. We are as stupid, and everything we do is equally stupid. So we have to kind of beat ourselves over the head and try to clean it up, yeah? That's the point I'm making. Now, what about measure spaces? So, entropy. So entropy, I said, has this, I have this kind of trend-time multiply thing, and this exactly corresponds to what we should think. That you count the number of states, but you may assume you have a big system, all states are the same. And that's the whole point, because things repeated, they're always the same. And therefore, entropy compute them properly. And then when you make this kind of multiply the thing and look at the larger numbers, you come with this formula minus pi log pi. And what made me think there might be some nonsense behind it, first I never could learn this formula. Plus, minus, epsilon. And remember, I needed some little kind of identity. And I look at the internet, and I just read tens, hundreds of books, exposition of entropy. And so what I observed, they were repeating word for word one of the first articles. There is cut and paste. Nobody ever thought the hell what they were writing. Fantastic, you know, all these great people, but when you write, because they knew the original paper they came from. It was paper by Roffin, from the ergodic theory.
Your advisor.
Yeah, he wrote this and knew it very well, and this formula, and some of them was missing, and everybody was just taking the whole block and kept repeating. So nobody ever thought what the hell is it. It's incredible. So, intelligence, and then you start thinking a little bit, and then you realize that you can define entropy from what I said, looking at this picture, and it's just exactly what physicists do, without knowing what logarithms. I don't know, it's too complicated. Yeah. So what you say is as follows. What you have, a finite measure.
So what is the thing intuitively that we're trying to understand now? It's called entropy. What?
I describe this picture. There are the system and there are the number of states of logarithm you take, but you can pretend all states are equal because of that process I described.
Yeah,
now
yeah.
I want to make definition of entropy for finite measure space using this idea.
But you just said this word entropy. What is it?
Okay, you'll see in a second. Yeah. It's something that something nice in nature. No. What exactly what measures the number of state of physical system? So I want to make sense of the sentence. And the system describes a density of something. You observe some densities. You put your machine and you see that one window flickers more often than another. Right? And so there are densities and this gives you entropy. And you have to not know what the system is. And just this flickers. And so what you have, and this is what in practice you observe, is a bunch of these numbers, sum equals
but
to one.
Is this an intensive quantity? Intensive quantity or extensive quantity?
Yeah, I don't know this word.
The log of the number of states is like how much is there?
Yeah, but then we return to that.
Huh?
We shall come to that.
Right.
When you start describing in terms of blocks of matter, it makes sense. So far it's just a result of observation. You make this machine and you have windows and there are frequencies of blinking in each of these windows. So I have these numbers, PI, period, all I have. From there I produce a number. How you interpret in the second stage, it will be neither of the two. It's kind of same energy function. And this is Shannon inequality. We may not go to it. It's in the next step. But anyway, so how to do what we have? So we have this thing, and very simple morphism, when some drops of water come together and add up. So we have a little drop of water, and some of them merge, and you have a new stream. And so it looks almost like partial order. And this is another interesting point, this tremendous advantage of category theory of language, of course, over their partial order. Because if you write A greater than B, and you want to work, and in category you say there is an error from A to B. So what's the advantage of error? And this happens all the time with entropy. If you have two objects together with error, you have to write, say, entropy, apply two pairs, write this, comma, this. So you need three symbols for that. But if you give it name, F, it will only one. And this is not a joke. So article, you may have hundreds of pages filled by this kind of junk. You just carry symbols you never use, because you only use F, you don't use this. And this is not a joke, I mean, just, you know. Your mathematical
life. What is the advantage?
Instead of three letters, use one.
No, I know, but your partial order set and category.
No, well, first, one point is very many construction, category theory immediately applies to partial set, they're universal. There's nothing special about order. But notationally, my point is notationally, it saves notations. And that's the thing is absolutely crucial, because you know this problem. Just you write some article, and you think it's just one line, it has the five pages. What the hell? Because you know how to say it. Because your language is idiotic. And you can convey your idea when you read also. Because you lost in the absolutely random stuff. You don't know how to say it right. So the right language is not a joke.
What is the situation you're describing by two languages? One is partial set. There's morphism between two probability spaces? What is the thing you're discussing?
I'm discussing two probability spaces. And there is a morphing one to another. They also
and what's the definition of morphism? Just a map? What is a morphism?
Oh, for me it would be just error. I don't care that it would map. But exactly, if I forget it was map, it would be error. It's just combinatorical of this error. That's the whole point of category theory. You forget.
That's your point. But I mean, what is a morphism of probability space?
Yeah, it's a map from one measure space to another, which measure preserving map.
It's a map.
But finite measure spaces.
But
in fact, you can think about this, it's actually just an array of numbers. You don't have to have a map, yeah? You go from one array of numbers to another array of numbers. So it's just all about numbers, there is no spaces. And the moment you said it, so how you define this entropy? And the entropy defined by the property. First it defined, so what I say will be, not quite. Honest, yeah, but this is exactly how we think, and then you have to make sense of that. You say, I have this category. And then you say, you take topological semigroup, growth index semigroup of this category. So I think this category is partially defined, kind of monoid in some operation, and you add relation being commutative when invertible, invertible you can forget the same group, and you have abelian same group. And then
you mean the morphisms of this category form an abelian semi group.
Exactly. So you just now abelian group, semi group.
Semi group.
And because there is this numbers, there is little topology. You have to say what topology is important. And topology exactly corresponds to what I am saying. When you take multiply space by itself many, many times, and you throw away little piece, and what remains is close to constant. So you have to make topology corresponding to this picture, okay, right, to make definition adequate. And then you say, so then this semigroup will be exactly the multiplicative semigroup of positive numbers bigger than one. By the law of large numbers. Because if you start space multiplying by itself, I assume this functoriality implies this semigroup will multiply because you converge to something with constant atoms. So what remains cardinality of that under multiplication. And so everything, manipulation with entropy is the same as manipulation with cardinality in a very precise sense. And then you take log of that and you have the entropy. Okay, log, there is some meaning of log, which I don't quite understand. In a second they say, why log is not a joke? There is justification for the log. But I don't fully understand it yet. This is a different kind of mathematics which I don't understand.
Don't you want to like the product to go to the entropy or the product to go to the sum of the entropy?
No, if you take log.
How the log comes?
No. But why you want it? This is very stupid. Why you want it? So you say, some people say addition is simpler than multiplication. As I remember, I was explaining as a child why in my time all cars had kind of the rear wheel drive. Yeah, and they say, oh, pushing is easier than carrying. Addition is not multiplication. No, the reason is I can say. What's remarkable about log? It's not accidental. If you look this function, pi log pi, is exactly this pi, is a function on the simplex. Right? So it's function on the simplex. And we shall see today, I don't know what to say, we see that this function is convex, or concave, whichever, by Shannon inequality. Therefore, the Hessian of this function is a quadratic form, differential quadratic form. And you can take a metric to this form. So it has some Riemannian metric. The question is, what kind of metric it is? How it looks like, right? And actually, again, this is some people, of course.
Does it have a sign?
Huh?
Curvature of a sign?
Yeah, but what is the sign of the curvature? It's positive, negative, constant, variable, what? But look, so it's very funny. So I just, somebody told me, you know this called King and Tani, some Shahani metric, some mathematical biologist, because somebody told me that. And I started looking at this Shahani metric, and they were kind of my discussion of explaining what it is, and somebody said, why the hell you call Shahani? Because it was invented by many people. Actually, it was first probably written down by Fisher. Fisher was studied quite a bit by people in statistics, but I didn't know that. But this guy also didn't know that. Why it's called the Shahani metric? Because he obviously discovered himself. It is just metric of constant curvature. It is exactly metric of the square in the sphere. Now, if you take and it comes by a real part of the moment map. If you can see the map of complex projective space to the sphere, then it's locus on the real sphere. It exactly induces this metric. And so what's
I forgot the metric already.
Huh?
I forgot what the metric is already.
It's metric, it's a Hessian of the entropy.
Oh, the Hessian of the entropy.
Hessian of the entropy. And it's exactly the same potential which enter, you know, this in a complex analysis when you write metric associated to the connection and Hermitian structure is quadratic. So this log non-accident has algebra geometric meaning of many formulas which people write now like some Grothendieck type integral. Instance of that, which actually suggests that there might be something much more profound than usual entropy.
So can you explain it without going through all that fancy stuff?
Huh?
Can you explain why this, you've explained the entropy in terms of the semigroup structure.
Yeah.
Can you now explain the
entropy? No.
Huh?
No. Some say, well, there's some geometric quantization over projective space, I don't understand. People try to explain it, I couldn't, I think, understand it. In order to understand, you have to, for me, understanding means push it much further. And to have a much bigger class of such objects. And I believe to any algebraic variety or many classes of algebraic varieties, give you some counterpart of entropy probability theory. There are probability theory associated not with real numbers, but with partial ordering, say, coming from the Hodge theory. And this is what comes from the complex projective space. Here, positivity comes from positivity of intersection in the complex projective space. And
so you're saying probability is just one little piece of this big geometric theory.
Oh, some big geometric.
Therefore, probability theory should
right.
be
exactly.
to
uplifted there, yeah. Okay. But I'm pretty certain that I wish it, it should be like that. I don't know how to do it. But that's exactly my feeling. So that's another point about probability. But that's another, I thought a little bit that I couldn't do that. But now a few words about what a measure space from this point of view. So once you have it, now you want to know what a measure space. And so we have this little category of finite measure spaces. And I'm saying out of this, we can make category of all measure spaces. This is probability measure space. Or at least of Lebesgue measure spaces. You don't care about each other of Lebesgue. Those which you have missed. And then a very simple way to do it, you just say, aha, it is just, I keep forgetting, co-contravariant functor from this category to category of sets. It is covariant functor from this category to the category of sets. With some little properties which are usually immaterial, because what much of what you may say will be true for all these functors. And in particular, so you can think about that. This function, in other words, to think kind of completion, kind of formal completion of this category. So for each object here, so from the big category of measure spaces, we have a morphism here. So we have this object over here, and they have morphism everywhere. And so it come here, and then other morphisms follow, right? Because morphisms have the same properties. And therefore, everything we speak about finite measure spaces automatically extends to these categories, including entropy, strata, delta. And if you return to the question of situational lattices, how physicists measure entropy? Of course, they just postulate that entropy of some unit block is one, and then normalize it going around the lattice. And the answer doesn't depend how you measure it. And that's exactly the invariance of the entropy. And if you just repeat these words in these things, it's just tautology. There's nothing to prove. I actually wrote it down, there's nothing to prove. It's just you say these words physicists say, and just give him the name for them. And then you have both, you see, statement of the theorem and the proof. And this was all implicitly reinforced. He knew this to the soul, of course, yeah, in different terms. Of course, the language is not a joke, I mean. And the set theoretic language and probability theory was a big achievement in some time of Kolmogorov, which you had to now have to appreciate. This probably was considered so serious because set theory was not so common. And now set theory is accepted by many, many mathematicians. So that's about.
So what is the factorial description that you just gave?
I can hidden what I have behind me because I learned the classical definition. Of course, I do it having it in mind. So it is a functor from its covariant functor from the category of finite measure spaces to the category of sets. So it's a topos, yeah. You can say exactly what the
group. That is what, and that functor is what?
It's measure spaces. So its functor is a measure space.
How do you get from measure space such a functor?
Because I can see all maps from here a partition. So they partition it together knowing who goes where. So they just partition with a name for every element. And all you need for entropy, this is exactly how you define it, was. But you don't need the measure space for that. And this exactly, it is in the Kolmogorov in his paper making mistakes. Lost in this measure, set theoretic subtleties of measure spaces. He was making mistake there.
And how was the set of partitions related to functors from this category to category of sets?
Again, because it is from functorial. If you have one partition, another partition, you can intersect them, you have to another partition. And this is functor. And that's all you use. You use nothing more than that.
What's a functor?
This assignment to that finite measure set, the set of maps from measure space to the set. You can see that all partition is given weight, so to speak.
Oh, yeah.
And this is a set. And this is a set. On a set. And you don't care, big, small, whatever. It's abstractly element of the category of sets. And then you don't have to know anything else. And that's again, this is what's nice about category theory. From this moment on, automatically you get everything. You don't have to think. Right? You just write down what this tells you to write, and you write down, and everything fits because it's just a commutativity of diagrams. Sometimes you need some typical thing like the Beck's lemma, but it also immediately fits in there. And the measure space you get are more general than usual measure spaces. It's not, they're not useful for some reason. They're not incomplete. But all theory is not true for them anyway. They're just, they're less powerful. They're maximal, so you've got maximal measure space which is complete in section. But you don't need it for all these theories. For definition entry. Okay?
Sorry, could you repeat the assignment from the finite measure to the set? What, how are you gonna?
So if you have true measure space, then to each finite measure space, you assign the space of all map from one to another. What does this mean? They are partitioned into elements, which named after this, in each weight equal to this weight. So it's a space of partitions. And again, the point is you work only with the measures, weights of these partitions. You don't need the space. You don't need this point. Yeah. You only need relation between these numbers.
Yeah, can I summarize what you just said?
Yeah.
If you work in measure theory, the Lebesgue spaces, which were invented by his thesis advisor, Rockton. Have you read that paper, by the way, of Rockton?
Yeah, maybe. I'm not certain.
I have.
Yeah.
Anyways, one learns that you just use partitions, and you can work with finite partitions. In all measure theory, you can just discuss with partitions. These are just sets that have certain masses, right? So he's saying all those manipulations can be restated just in terms of category theory with functors to sets to this category of his finite measure spaces and the manipulation of category theory without having to mention the probability spaces. Although some functors don't correspond to nice probability spaces, but all the theorems are true anyway. That's what he said.
Yeah, exactly. But then when I try to go much further, for example, to try to do this for dynamical system like the Bowen does, and you make, from this point, you make some conjectures, but they happen to be wrong. This suggests what should
so
be true.
So you're an honest man.
Yeah, it should be, but this happened to be not true. He kind of pointed immediately, have the example there. How his entropy should behave, yeah. Like Shannon type of equality. And then again, coming to Shannon equality, so this, now it may say what kind of entropy looks from this extensive or expansive, whatever. So I have a bunch of atoms. And then you have some, say, subset in the space of state. And then you, if you pick some part of the atom, you project the set on this part. And so we have entropy attached to this projection of the measure, right? So when you have this physical system, if you take each block of that, there is entropy, and each state now is some spread, or maybe measure upstairs, or state upstairs, set upstairs, you project it, and then you have a number, entropy is assigned to each block of matter. So, and the question is, it's extensive or expansive, but there is fundamental Shannon equality, which says, so we have this picture, which says A, so 1, 1, 2, and 2, and then the whole thing will be big one, so the entropy of the big one is less or equal than 1 plus 2 minus 1, 2. Right, so the entropy of the union of two sets smaller than some of the ingredients minus, which is even better, what was in the intersection. And this is a property of the entropy. So it's not quite energy. Yeah. It's neither
local. The inequality goes, I can't read what you wrote there.
So. It's okay, so you have some state in the space of your crystal, and you look at this junk of matter, you have, it may be described this way. 1, 2, 3. And then entropy 1, 2, 3 less or equal than 1, 2 plus 2, 3 minus 2. So we have this set and this set. Right, 1, 2, and 2, 3, their sum dominate the whole thing, even if you subtract what's here. Yeah, this is Shannon equality. And this is how we prove that, because we know what entropies are, we can assume that all these sets are just all weights are equal, everything is true, and this corresponds to the fact that cardinality is monotone on the injective maps. Not subjective, that's interesting, it's injective. And this is related to what Boren does, because, you know, it's not, his entropy is not kind of behaving well, on the morphism of measure spaces, they are not But when you look carefully, it's related to injectivity, not to subjectivity. And this is why I thought his interview will behave, will satisfy this kind of inequality, but it doesn't. And maybe the...
She comes at 3:30.
3:30?
Yeah.
Okay, so I can continue. And then interesting,
you can hold out. She at 3:30, right here. Yeah. Can they get in? Well, maybe.
Oh, what?
You'll have to let them in when they come.
So let me finish, say two words about entropy and then turn to other spaces. And what I'm using, if you use the same kind of logic to the quantum phenomenon entropy, and phenomenon, so you have now quantum physical system, and just the same inequality, but now they, in a second they say what is quantum entropy, you have this inequality. And this was proven by Liebig and Ruskai about 40 years ago. And it was sophisticated proof using some operator calculus, some highly non-trivial, things, yeah. In a second, I'll give you an idea what kind of stuff they use. I may be slightly mistaken, but something like that. Imagine you have operators, you have function of self-adjoint operator. So when such a function will be monotone, is a function in the partial order of operators, what function it should be? And just to have an idea, that there is, if I'm not mistaken, theorem of Lovne, I guess, if and only if this function analytic, it extends to upper half plane and injects with that. So, and there are kind of, you know, it's beautiful kind of, and there are quite a few kind of, this kind of theorem they're using. And of course, I never could read it. There was short proof by Ruskai, maybe one page, but using similar kind of tricky computation. But then they realized that if you would say what I said, and there is one. And you don't have to say anything. This, from this factorial, you go to the limit, and without, and nobody, these people don't believe me, by the way. I spoke to people, no, you mean probably something else. They believe it's very kind of really sophisticated theorem. It's just hand waving. You use nothing, Pythagorean theorem, maximum in Hilbert spaces. You have to see what means Hilbert spaces, and you go to the limit, and you go to the limit, think reduced to some topology. And the question you have to justify again, you can go to this limit. And it's a really kind of tautological theorem. Well, of course, I must say, I use, of course, what I use implicitly is that the function, we have quadratic form, point indefinite quadratic form, square of the norm is function on the sphere, perfect Morse function. It's one critical point for one eigenvalue. I use this kind of piece of mathematics. And the rest is just nothing. It's just pure logic. But now I want to look at other examples of spaces. This I kind of little bit thought and I have conclusive results. But I think that there are many other instances of spaces which we don't know yet. I think it may be happening there. So maybe concerning probability, this was kind of formal part of that. Of course, there is completely different aspect which is related but indirectly to what probability, how it works in physics and how it should work and why it doesn't work, say, in linguistics or in biology. And that's quite long story, maybe I don't have to.
Well, we can have tea and discuss.
Yeah, I may maybe speak a little bit about that. But it's also, it's mathematical, but then it becomes not so pretty. I mean, this becomes somewhat mathematical, which eventually must go to computers. So concept of probability is it, and then we have the Chomsky who emphasized it, is inapplicable. You cannot apply it to the language. And of course, one of the reasons is, which of course he would say, because set of sentences is not a set. So when you say, mathematicians say, what is language? It is a set of things, or it's probability, it's not true. It is not a set. There is no such set as set of sentences. And this is an amusing point, let me explain okay, for trivial reason. And the number of sentences ever said or will be said on Earth, or in this universe, is bounded by a small number, 1 million. Certainly much less than that. Yeah. It's a tiny little number. And those you can, so what do you mean can? You can write. Certainly it is much more than that. Now, can you give me an example of a sentence you can't write?
No.
You can't, because if you write it, it will be there. You see? So it's a set. If you give an element there, it will be not there. Yeah? And this is kind of nothing paradoxical in that, but it's just language not adequate. Right? You don't have a defined set, being kind of more like a category. When you need something, you take it. But it's not there before you took it. Like in quantum mechanics, yeah? particle is not there unless you take it. You look at this. It's not there.
It doesn't exist a priori.
Yeah, it doesn't exist. Well, that's a formalism such that you can manipulate a set theory. It's somewhat limited to what you do. Nothing wrong, you still can do lots of stuff. Yeah. All the other work is categories. The set of arrows are not set. You have all these diagrams, whatever, they need them, but they don't kind of part of the subject bigger. Unless this big array will be written on your paper. And that is a kind of interesting point. And this, I think, how you have to model process in your mind. Yeah, you have to keep this in mind. It's not a set state of your brain. This I'm saying, set or space or states or bad notions. But I want to look at another example, which coming from rather concrete from biology, where I suggest that maybe very interesting mathematics. Again, I fail to find it. And this is about how your cell is made. And in very rough approximation, your cell is made out of...
Your cell.
Cell.
C-E-L-L. Oh. One of my cells is made.
Okay. Well, actually, this applies best to something like erythrocytes. They are rather simple cells. And now they're more complicated. And of course, by the way, when you say your cell, what do you mean yours? We cell you call yours and yours. Because you know that your cell constitute only 10% of your body, your cells, with your genome. And there are 90% bacteria living in your guts. You know, you have about 2 kilo of bacteria in your gut. And your shit is bacteria. And they determine your character. More than you think, yeah? Yeah, that's really kind of great stuff, yeah. And, you know, in this genotype, you're only 1 or 2%, because there are more variety of gene bacteria than you. So if by number of cells you're 10%, but the number of different genes, you're only 1.5%. And so, but anyway, this is important. And so it consists of this bilipid molecules, if you don't care about the bilipid lab, but the perpendicular, the position of this perpendicular position. Of course, it's more complicated because there are description of proteins that completely change the picture. But this is very rough picture. And so we have this object. So what's interesting about it? That you have a membrane, but this membrane is not one-dimensional. It's organized, it consists of this normal direction today. Yeah? And this is how you represent you represent manifolds by Tom map. You have manifolds in the Euclidean space. Forget those manifolds. You remember these normal spaces, and you map it to the classifying space. And this what is physically indeed, you may think in some in our surface. And then they take certain shapes. And if there is nothing else, it will be actually spherical. And then you say, it's spherical. Because if you approximate this tension between these things, the forces which are there, which are not there, this, by the way, don't interact. These individual things, they don't interact. And they take the shape not because they stick together, but because for the entropic reason. Because in this reason system of these things plus water, entropy is being minimized. Right? Because it's a kind of... they maximize number the degree of freedom because if they go outside, when molecules of water getting stiff here and lose their degree of freedom. And this way, water more free because most entropy belongs to the water. So it's water gives the shape, not intrinsically. But anyway, you can write however.
Water is on the outside?
From outside, yeah. But there are much more water molecules and they carry much more entropy. But still you can say, this kind of imaginary tension. And you kind of write these equations, and if there is nothing else, it is spherical, and your erythrocyte has this shape. Because it's constrained by area of the surface plus the volume of the interior, and minimizes the square curvature, But nobody proves it, by the way. That this will be this provided a spherical shape. And then you start thinking about that,
you can formulate a precise differential unit.
Yes, it's absolutely. It says you bound all surfaces with given volume inside, given area, minimum square energy of the surface, square integral curvature, minimized by something radially symmetric, and then you say it might be this big concave. That's probably you can compute. Your ODE is kind of, you can approximately solve or something. But how to show it is spherically symmetric. And this is radially symmetric. And you can make many conjectures. So and then you suggest lots of such variation problem on one hand. When you have constraints on one integral and look at that in higher dimensions, and you have a host of conjectures, motivated by that, of course, non-justified because nothing is known. But it's much more interesting, in my view, to think about that is as it is. It's a bunch of these molecules. So if you change the temperature and heat the stuff up, they all go away. And then they come back and make this shape. So the point I want to make, conjecture, is that this ensemble of these molecules knows these differential equations even when it's heated up. Because it's kind of an analytic process. So you can describe these differential equations in terms of ensemble of this kind of particles. And so what you want to do, translate all significant part of the theory of differential equations to this language. So spaces will disappear. There will be no points or differential equations, but there will be some ensembles. And inside, so what makes any kind of theory of differential equations meaningful is presence of Bochner-type formulas. If you don't have Bochner formulas, that's junk.
You can leave that Bochner formula.
It's formulas, it's some not identities where some derivative being excluded. Like, look at the Hodge formula. You start with the function a priori harmonic on a Keller manifold, but a posteriori it will be pluriharmonic. Because this identity is saying there's some quadratic terms and positive whatever. And then theory saturated. Without that, it's just empty. And only this is significant, in my point of view, from what's the equation. You forget about differential equation. There is algebraic formula. But you have to interpret it, not in the language of differential equation, but in the language of the ensembles. And then you have infinitely better theory. There will be no equation, it will be much more general, and you'll prove, will be incomparably more. But I don't know what's going to do it. But this example gets instructive. And
well, you're intrigued by the memory. With the thing that you heat it up.
You heat it up, yeah, but still, I mean, there might be a way to interpret still, not the equation, but the formulas. And here also, there is some Bochner formulas, Gauss formula, actually. But this formula still lives there. Let me give another example, when it's kind of metaphorically when this happens. Which I keep repeating, yeah. And then again, understanding of mathematics, if you understand the nature of mathematics, you could do it automatically. And so one example which I love, you know. So what is so special about it? Yeah. 2 plus 2 is 4. And yes, when I bring you smiling, we understand. No.
Not at all.
Because what's the difference here and here? This fundamental difference.
And what's the other one?
And this 3 plus 3 is 6. And the point is here you can make the decomposition. 4 points in three in two groups in three different ways. And here it will be something 12. And the point is 3 is less than 4. And 12 is bigger than 6. And so if you start thinking about that, then what will be next step? You observe, it means the group.
Wait, 3 is less than what?
Than four.
And 4 is what?
2 plus 2 is 4.
Yeah, no, but three ways to divide 4 things.
The number of the composition of 4 elements points into two groups.
The 3 ways. That's less than 4.
Yeah, but if you have
so
six.
Wait, what's the 4?
Hmm? 4 points. You have 4 points, and you divide into 2 equal groups. The number of division is 3.
Yeah.
Which means that the group is kind of permutation of 4 elements goes to 3. And if you look at the next level thing, it's about this wild group for orthogonal group. You see that orthogonal group, or the algebra, in dimension 4, it splits into parts. Therefore, there's something special about the variation equation in this dimension. You have Young-Hill's equation. You have Donaldson theory and everything else. And they come from here. The question is how to do it formally. And some people come in their brain, they quit and exactly think like that. They start with this, write these big formulas.
And maybe it's a
Donaldson
theory.
Yeah, exactly. It's something, yeah. Sort of. And they say there might be a mechanical way of doing that.
I'm missing the point. Why is knowing the number of ways of dividing 4 into 2 parts?
No, because it's actually permutation, because it is homomorphism of permutation of a group of 4 elements to permutation of 3 elements. The reduction, of course, because you can solve equation of degree 4, reducing the equation of degree 3. This was known. And there is huge formula, by the way. If you look at the equation of degree 4, it takes all this blackboard. Yeah? It was just discovered by Cardano, yeah? And Ferrari. So those already highly non-trivial mathematics and already here, before Donaldson. But then you go next steps and just, on one hand you have the Gromov theory, on the other hand Donaldson theory, exactly understanding them. And the question is how to do it more mechanical. So I think that the more mechanical way to do this is, like you said, background, you have to create background, and then this will grow by itself. But you have to have right background. And so that's, and particularly here, well, I just had some tentative results, but they're certainly very far from what you want. And for algebraic geometry, you can imagine what it can be. So you have, instead of looking at, say, surfaces, hypersurfaces, where I look at the kind of space of curves, you go to bigger and bigger spaces and forget much of the points. So people do this usually in linearized language in categories of sheaves, but, well, for me, it will be more attractive to do it geometrically. So it will cover examples when you cannot do algebra. So what else am I saying? Now,
well, say something about space.
About space, yeah. But this exactly my point about space was that I want to
get rid of it.
Get rid of it, yeah. Well, let me give you another example. Just I don't know what it's good for, but you think about just metric spaces. About metric spaces, and then there is triangle inequality. And for triangle inequality, it's obviously just saying this clinical means you can compositional errors. And this is a triangle, right? You go from A to B to C, this path from here to here, right? So what would be the right, but there are real numbers attached to it, of course. And so you can say, aha, another way to say it, well, what is it? Metric space is a functor from category of points of sets of cardinality of triples of points of the line under kind of trivial operations to the category of sets. So because you know when a couple of points map there is a distant decreasing map. And then you can discuss, speak about, but that does not open there so much possibility. So I you have to invent the interesting examples. And there are similar situations, of course, in symmetric spaces, which you can interpret as metric space with waves and this wild chamber or some cone, but it's not that good. So my interest here is actually understanding exactly the same languages. Yeah.
But why isn't that pretty good? Why don't you abstract that, this idea of the vial columns generalizing?
No, it has the satisfactory, for example, triangle inequality, it's rather non-trivial theory.
Right. So, and those are examples, don't they?
Yeah, but it's rather limited, yeah.
Rather what?
They're limited. I don't know a sufficient kind of pool of examples of these kind of objects. I just don't know it. So this is suggestive, but because you have something nice coming out of that. So one thing is to make something nice come within kind of mathematics or maybe without. And the obvious field of application which mathematics so far do not significantly apply is languages.
Is what?
Languages.
Oh.
If you look, so it was studied by Zedek Harris, application of mathematical languages systematically, and then was taken partly by Chomsky, who was not for long there. But it was mathematics of essentially of 19th century. So the last kind of, macabre piece of mathematics they used with this speaker, the Chomsky's Turing machine, from bottom point of Turing machine is a monster, it's not even a mathematical object. And so what is the right way to speak about languages, how to describe them? And this might be rather primitive mathematics. You don't expect anything sophisticated. Let me give one little point. However, what you can do that speak about languages. So you don't speak, again, you don't mention such thing as space of all sentences. You just forget about it. But how you can think about text? So again, naively, definition, it will be just strings of, you have four so many letters, you have these strings.
And this is what?
The strings of letters from a given alphabet. Yeah. It's kind of horrible definition. But linguists hate it, and I also hate it. I say that. Why is it so stupid? Because immediately comes to your mind. Immediately. Start to come so fast to your mind, might be stupid. And then you already checked. But this slightly different, also simple thing, which is more powerful and which covers, which applies to essentially, I believe, the basis for perception of anything, including languages, is the following. What is essential, so what is immediately wrong about that? You give different names, X, Y, and Z. And you have different language, right? Because it's set. Given a set, and then you have a language. Can you get another set? Another language, no. So how to go around it? In the language of sets, it's really useless. But categorically, and what actually is relevant, is, let me give, actually interrupt myself and tell you some little story, just to make a point. Yes, there is a I've forgotten, there is some properties that people have, claim they have, they see numbers in colors. For example, they claim they see 7 blue and white red. How to
blue,
check?
7 blue and 5 red. Red.
For example, and how to check whether they are saying truth or they lie.
You have to check whether they really think 7 is blue and
yeah,
5 is
red. Right.
Ask them regularly over a period of time.
No, but there is an experiment, there is a genius, it's a rare case, but there is a genius experiment psychology. By the way, I'm really shocked, I just looked at what I said, what is the best experiments in psychology? Any idiot can make them, the idiot. And this one not mentioned, dry, interesting one. But this is fantastic, I have it selected. Exactly, experiment for idiots. But this is an ingenious experiment. That's very simple. The idea is, has idea. Yeah. And the idea is follows. You men go out of the room, and beside on the room on the blackboard, you write lots and lots of 5, and here in the center, you have more 7 than 5. And he comes in, here is a red disk in the center. And if you don't distinguish them, you can't say, right? However, somebody will ask, how you know it was blue? Maybe he was seeing red or green. When he was seeing green, saying red. Can you check that? No, it's meaningless question. There is no meaning to colors. You only say if colors are equal or not. Therefore, also for that sentences, you cannot say what letters in the sentence. The only point, some are equal in some sense and some are not. And then what you have, in fact, when you have this string of letters, you have a category of translation. But now you can see the only translation which fit the sentences. And this category, this graph, describes the language. So you can forget completely about letters. If you only have, you have two relations, being neighbors and being the same. And so these two graphs together make a graph, and this graph is a language. Of course, it's...
But so you first get a tree, and then you glue together if they're the same?
No, first you have just these points on the line. This is neighbors.
So what are these things? It's like these are words that follow each other in a sentence?
The words, or maybe anything you want, maybe spoken sentences or whatever. And then there is...
But how's it ordering? What does it mean to be a neighbor?
Yeah, actually, without that, you know, it's first they're written, of course, somewhere, or it may be temporal order in the speech, or it may be spatial structure in the space, and in the space will be more complicated. But this, you have a background space. Without that, there is no language. If there is no background structure, like you cannot make language out of smells. They fly on the ground. You cannot make them. Though we have many different smells, but you cannot use them. They might be attached to some physical background. Usually it's with symmetry, it's high symmetry, but still rather low dimensional. And then some patterns you consider as identical. And moreover, there is a process how you move there. And it's important which there is a process. It's actually error. Here is just one arrow, but there may be many arrows. If you look, if I give you two shapes, or there are two people who are similar, it is a process how you identify them, right? You match this pattern with this pattern with this pattern, so there is something, and something maybe not even category, but rather two category, but it's an elaborate process. But there is no sense there, of course, yeah? So all you have this kind of a category of identification of different patterns. And this category, of course, is not quite category. Like I say category because you can't compose indefinitely. You can compose 1, 2, 3, and then you die. Right? So it is kind of category. And that's one of the difficulties in from formalizing it. How many steps you allow before this thing becomes become needed. And this describes languages, and this, I think, describes the way our
men work. Can you make a concrete construction? Mm-hmm. Can a language take one particular thing, like words or phrases, and make this graph?
No, but this trivial graph, this is, of course, super trivial. I mean, just it's not really the real real stuff. It's the beginning of saying how you can eliminate this stupid definition. Of course, there are much more errors. It's not that simple. Of course, there are much more errors, there are much more sophisticated errors inside of the language. Right, because you can compression, you can have extension, you can have translation, and all these errors have some combinatorics in them. And that's what makes the language. This is a...
No, but I don't understand this basically what the errors are.
Oh, no, he just error if some strings equal to another strings here, is an error going to here.
But what are those things, though, in language?
Not written letters. It's letters or words, whichever. But again, it's now became a material, something written on the line. And whichever you use, it's a material, how you write it, what is there, whether it's symbols or letters or whatever.
You notice this structure, though.
Yeah, you start from this structure. Some patterns are equal. And from that, you can make tremendous richness, because you're already there on the line, and plus another one, so you have graphs, you have everything. So it completely describes the language.
So you can be getting a signal from outer space, and you can start to analyze it this way.
Yeah, but of course it's very primitive kind of the beginning, yeah? But this is from where you start. But then, of course, there are hierarchy of errors which you have to look into. That's the beginning of it. I mean, by no means this is the end. It's like a preliminary illustration of the power of the errors. They tell you everything. And you forget what you don't have to know. This is already excessive information. And if you speak, look at the spoken languages, where you teach it, which things are equal, which are not. And this, of course, kind of variable, yeah? And that's very crucial, because there are two the languages are different, spoken language and written language. They are not the same language. And people usually speak what's a written language, because you don't know what spoken language is, yeah? How people speak, we don't know that well. I mean, it's really much harder to analyze. Say, grammar, etc. It's not that clear, right? But this description already is universal from where you start, right? So in this way you have your data, and then you have to weigh how to deal with that. But that's universal way to describe that also I'm saying for images. And this is indeed how you speak images. You don't care about spatial things. I'm pretty certain that there are some data from physiology, I believe, they only say, there are certain similar patterns, and you identify these patterns. And many things can be analyzed looking at Sakari Kaibu, how they run between different patterns, how they can reconstruct symmetries and whatever. So that is, and the question is, what should we want mathematics here? Of course, this is kind of trivial stuff, yeah? But besides, there are next level which is not so obvious, how you operate. And so it's more than that. But that's another story which kind of spaces enter, which are not spaces. That's exactly the point. You can people start to think about this space of all sets of all possibilities. It's not so. The words set and the word all are not right. We don't know what it is. Because if we had anything applicable to all possibilities, it wouldn't work. That's the whole point. And this all is algorithm, whatever you do, either they specialize or they apply to everything. None of them work. And the point is you have to aim at something you don't know what it is. This something you don't know what it is, very special, you don't know what it is. And you have to make algorithms applicable to that without knowing it. And that's tricky. A system must be not idiotic, idiotic in a sense, like black box, like neural networks. And they sometimes work, sometimes don't, but you refuse to think how they work. You just take them for granted and judge them. Of course, you can do that, but you'll never go beyond some trivial stuff with them. And so far, on one hand, was tremendous progress in a technical kind of quantitative way, qualitatively, they were zero. We cannot imitate anything with any understanding. Most primitive human, and possibly some animal behavior. That's another point. If there is a difference, a significant difference. But of course, the point is to understand language from this point of view. And so, what is carried inside of the language? And you have huge now material you can take it from internet, and something I think something my point of view is I'm using how much you can do and how where you have abstraction. For example, easily you can I think make understanding jokes. Very simple, algorithm can understand joke. Or understanding why birds fly more than pigs. You know? Pigs fly as common in the internet as say. Take any particular bird, flies certainly much less than pigs. Like sparrows flies, you know, 10 times rare, more rare than the pigs. However, very simple, combinatorical of this, graphs immediately tell the difference. You know? So the pig is not anything but just not in this graph. And you see how it looks around here, how birds look, and you see the sparrows and say, you know, crows have very similar constellation of arrows, and pigs will be very different. But what you cannot do, and I think still people cannot do it, is understand the function of pronouns. No matter how you can fit in all the grammar of the language you know, and still you can't recognize pronouns. And there is a good reason for that. They're very, very logically complicated. Actually, from a mathematical point of view, think, what is a pronoun? And if you really don't understand. And this is part of the point. I mean, there is
much one level up, there's an analogy going on.
Yeah, no, well, it's just we don't know. We don't know what it is mathematically. Here, of course, this level of abstraction, we don't know what it is, but it's such a way to create it. And we have to have a mathematical way, a mathematical meaning. You create theory where we know nothing about languages, very general, and then there's something like pronoun there. They say, now we know what it is. You cannot explain it within the language. This is not a general principle. Nothing can be explained within. The only way to do it without. You have to go outside and create some new theories, and then in the same way you can speak about what you study. And for that reason, you can't understand languages if you only speak about languages. You have to have or human mind. You have to have some more mathematics. You have to have much broader domain where this will find their place. And that's spaces, just starting point, not kind of, because that's, we know, we think we better know what it is, than say pronouns. Of course, it's much easier to speak about. Okay, I can't speak about some particular point.
So you know, Chomsky has
this...
Graduate 3 years ago. So you said you can't do differential equations if you don't have the Buckner.
Speak up, I can't hear you.
If you don't have the Buckner,
you can do it, but this is not the way it is.
Right.
Of course you can do it, but then you can't really prove a significant result. You never can, nothing outside can't, what doesn't go in. See, when there are Bochum think, you throw in something simple, make a variation, prove some existence, and boom, something comes down expect. Right?
That's curvature, basically.
Not only curvature. No, just the fact that in certain conditions, say, Bochum harmonic function might be constant. I mean, the harmonicity allows a lot, but then there is something particular making forces that will be more special than your strategy. But if you just prove existence or uniqueness, whatever, in general, you will just analyze specific behavior. It may be useful for practical applications of getting degrees, but it's not mathematically significant. But if you look at like Donaldson, it's not necessarily curvature. Curvature indeed is some symmetry in second derivative where you often involved, I agree with you. But not necessarily curvature. Or even say like Einstein equation, what makes it so incredible. Why it works, because if you look formally, what should be this equation when you take variation problem for curvature? It must be third order equation, or fourth order equation. No, this term disappear, and again, second order equation. That's what's so great about it. And so you have some cancellation, like d squared is zero, something like that, in some tricky way. And if you don't have it, well, you may have something with incomparably less interesting. That, of course, is subjective. But it's maybe not accidental. All great discoveries of partial differential equation came from geometry. They didn't come from partial differential equation for a very long time. They just clean up the point, but they don't discover new equations. From physics, of course, some others, I think, like there are, of course, not the integral equations, but again, there are hidden symmetries, which I understand less, so I wouldn't speak about it.
So is there a way to write it down categorically to describe like some sort of block?
No, this may be categorical. I had not here quite different point. I'm saying that given such an equation, and there are this kind of algebraic formula behind it, these formulas each determines the kind of outcome of this equation. And then can you only use this formula and forget about the equation? And particularly the best example in Hodge theory, because they give a transcendental method, proving algebraic theorems, in saying there are some rational saying holomorphic and holomorphic forms are algebraic forms, which a priori don't know. You know, you have this map to the abelian variety, which you prove by Bochner formula, right? You take harmonic map of Kelly manifold into Fourier torus, and Bochner formula tells you, the Cauchy formula, it is purely harmonic, and therefore in some parameters holomorphic. Right, and there is a formula. Can you use only this formula and see what it tells you without mentioning any maps or any equation or anything? And you can construct the theory. On the other hand, you can construct a billion varieties pure algebraically. The Jacobian can be made algebraically, but then it kind of looks somewhat different. But on the bottom, there may be some deep unity of that. But you, my feeling, you have to throw away differential equation. Replace them by something more sophisticated. But I thought a little bit about that, but I can say something, but not much. But that's one of the examples which you feel something definitely wrong, something fully, fundamentally not understood.
So, Going back to language,
yeah.
You know, Chomsky had this insight about if you want to write an article about dolphins,
yeah.
You think of the idea of dolphins and you say, I'm going to make four chapters. You make one chapter about feeding habits or one about environment. And so then what ends up happening is you get this structure so that words that are far away are more highly correlated than you'd expect because they trace through the idea that they're in one article, and there's like a hyperbolic distance on the words that makes them seem closer than they are in this linear distance.
Again, exactly what is linear and what is hyperbolic, I'm confused.
Well,
which words you have in mind?
Like the words in one essay, you know, one piece of text, words at the beginning and words that are far away tend to be more highly correlated than one would expect.
Correlated again in what sense? There's a correlation, I'm just thinking what do you mean by correlated? In what statistics? Correlated meaning, when we say correlated, you expect ensemble of events. What is an ensemble of events?
Well, you can define the sort of the mutual information in two, like correlation function between two words. So you could say, what's the probability of these two words appearing?
But the probability is not applicable here. This usual concept of probability here is inapplicable because things are highly heterogeneous. Probability, you can say this word, but the point when used in the most fundamental way, say in physics, say statistical mechanics, despite all nonsensical concepts, it works because of this huge symmetry. And you can assign probability, postulating them being equal, because they numbers themselves meaningful. On the probability of a state which has 10^-10^-10 assumption.
Yeah.
And this kind of probability meaningless concept. However, because you know that the system is symmetric, you can say they're equal. Even the numbers themselves are meaningless. And this equality makes it work. But the concepts of number is questionable. That's another thing, what I want to say. If you don't have it, you cannot say probability. You can say the words that you cannot. I'm sorry, actually, Chomsky himself emphasized there is no meaningful probability of things in the language. What is probability? Probability is not
the value of a probability.
No, this vague idea of probability, but the vague numerical value you have in probability is exactly what to assign to phenomenon, where something simple like a number. But a thing you can do it with not a number. Mm-hmm. It's very different, comes to very different. What you say is exactly this hierarchical structure. It's kind of the way, the tree, whatever. It is there, right? But it's not a number, there is no correlation in the usual sense. You can say this words, but they will be depending on how you look and where. And this must be incorporated into concept. And this is one of the aspects of probability which should be done, but this only makes sense if you look deeper in a particular domain, like languages, which I haven't done, because I don't know them well. And but there is, of course, much more striking phenomenon of that, which is a poetry. The poetry exactly brings words which has no meaning together by rhyme. And that has tremendous effect, but we love it for some reason. And that's, it's not the content of probability or whatever, right? You cannot say it publicly, but indeed you make shortcuts between words which are unrelated.
Yeah.
And about dolphin, I'm not certain, I don't know what the idea is. It's the idea of dolphin. So the word of idea, it's already
combinatorial structure there.
Well, what I was wondering is, in this description, this categorical description, this graph of this language graph, is this hierarchical consideration that went into a corpus of text.
No, of course, no, absolutely.
Is
no, like I said, this
present or has to
this
be
description
added?
Is zero, minus one level. Don't take it seriously. Uh-huh. It's minus one level. It just says that errors tell you immediately everything, but they don't tell you the right story. It's excessive. It's still hugely excessive. It might be tremendously compressed, reorganized, and I don't know how. If I knew it, I mean, we know the story, right? And I'm thinking about that, but it cannot be done within language itself. This is my point. You can make it abstract, general, whatever, and then apply it to languages. And you cannot do it in your head. You have to do it in computer, right? Computer problems you develop. So there might be some universal problems. If you feed them the language, they do organize them in a certain way. And I'm saying the starting point would be that. That's kind of where you start. And then you go to the next level. And I can speak a little bit what I think there should be next level. What are patterns from when you start with. But then, when you start thinking about that, you hit the wall, which everybody who try to do that, you know, people in IQ, artificial intelligence, and I have some idea at least what the wall is. Because you have to understand what the difficulty, why people cannot do what they try to do. What they're stupid, it's obvious, that's material. But it is technically a problem. And you want to mathematically understand where the problem resides and where it starts. And that's you have to do first before you try to solve it. Why we cannot assign formally pronouns to nouns. So what's the difficulty? Many things are very easy, but that's quite hard. And there may be mathematical or maybe conceptual explanation, saying that there is some input which is non-linguistic we have to keep in mind.
Yeah.
And but it would be very simple, but you have to say what it is, identify it. Again, formally, on the formal ground. So some words have colors, like emotions, yeah? What is emotion? Some words can be colors. You know, it's trivial stuff. The blue words, red words, maybe 100 colors, so on. People say, oh, emotion is trivial stuff. Yeah, the emotion absolutely important for our survival. But the survival is trivial aspect of the structure of the language. Yeah? So this is exactly why we are blinded by this, by usefulness, by survival. All this thing is, we have to forget, it's very difficult to forget about it. And understand the language from that perspective. They forget about its functions. And what Chomsky, in a way, tried to do that, but in my view, he's bound to very old-fashioned mathematics. And that's why the thing stopped. And this mathematics is no longer good. Like Turing machine, you know, Gödel, you know, Frege, it's just in the game. It's again, it's logic. The most illogical subject is logical. People make most mistakes. I mean, absolutely, I appeal to your intuition. See, it's only your intuition, so what may be less reliable, yeah? How you know something is true? You look inside of yourself, right, in logic. In the real world, you look what happens, and talk to other people, and see what's right or wrong. So there are much more supportive points. And this is only your intuition, some little thing in your some molecule in your brain, you have another idea. So how you can trust your intuition? And that's what you should do. So, again, this was like intuition, you know. Usefulness, creativeness, they're all bad words. They can confuse us. They're only kind of something we don't know about.
So you are saying there is no dimensional spirituality to any of, like, there is no place for, like, I don't know, I'm just saying that, is there any room for like, the spiritual aspect of...
Room where? Of course, we speak across the table, you can expect conversation. If you want to make a model,
right,
a functional model, forget about it. The same as for, you know, we can be the library creation of the world and just all its emotions, but you have to write formulas describing, you know, how words move. And this makes it, the spirituality excites us, but it's not the subject matter of the study. And exactly, you have to, well, it's very difficult to forget about this, I realize. You don't want to forget about this, you resist it. So you have to force yourself to do that. This is the conclusion I arrived at. And this even useful in mathematics. So you just look at something you were doing and then try to understand and accept that everything you were doing was wrong and try to do it differently. Intrinsically wrong, not mistaken, but just wrong. And that's fun, actually, yeah.
Especially
it's easy for you. You already have tenure. Yeah,
that's maybe the point. I agree. Of course, no. Of course, you have to arrive at this point. Yeah, it's not only tenure.
If you start writing papers, yeah. And you say everything is wrong. Sorry, interrupt.
Yeah, no, it's okay. It's okay.
You know.
Yeah.
You've had some fairly negative things to say about set theory and the reliance of set theory for measure theory,
right.
Specifically. But in your construction of, or discussion of what the measure space ought to be viewed as, a sort of approximation from finite measure spaces, taking a limit against an alter filter, you're appealing.
No, I don't do that alter filter.
You started.
Alter filter? No, it's okay. Not at that point. I'm saying, I, when I'm speaking about this, the alter field actually appears in the more in phenomenon probability. Here it's implicit. But of course, yeah, alter filter you can say it, you don't have to say it. You can say it not the phrase. Of course, I mean, I'm not engaging it. Of course, you still use it like here. But it's not kind of the core. Okay? It's only a fragment of what you do. There's another aspect that you do in different ways. You don't throw away these things. Of course, sometimes it's very good, but sometimes it's absurd. I mean, you're being just critical about it. I'm critical, but not I'm throwing it away, like you don't throw numbers or whatever. I'm very critical also about numbers. For example, in mind, there is no numbers. It's a number of different rules, but you cannot eliminate numbers. When you start looking from outside, you start counting. And this is all the time you like. You have mathematics and you have mathematical logic. And you can say, huh? Logic is called mathematics, but you do it for doing mathematics, which you can try to suppress. So you, all the time you have this problem. You throw away some language, you can criticize some language, but still use it. So I'm very critical of that, but still use it. That's the point. You can do it otherwise. When it works, it works. When it doesn't work, it doesn't. It's about point. You understand where you use correct language. Sometimes it's saturated and sometimes not.
Not this?
Because you see, we get carried away, very often carried away with the language too much. You say, this set of sentences is wrong. We can't apply saturated construction there. And metaphorically, you can say, that's fine. But then you start to take it literally. Or you say, there are infinitely many sentences. Metaphorically, it's fine, but it's meaningless when you say it's that taken literally, right? And that's the point.
Just remember that we're wrong.
Yeah, just remember it's wrong, so yes, but still metaphorically, no. That's the whole point. It's metaphor. We always use language impossible without being metaphoric in the essence of our language. And it's extremely very good. But you have to remember it's metaphor and then elaborate and have a new metaphor and then get a new metaphor. Not stick to the old one. That's the point. I think it's a great name, it's a theory, very, very good, up to date. Yeah, that is for the purposes which I have in mind, I don't know what the right language is. It's much easier to criticize.